Hey, it's Gregory Kallenberg from PrizeCast. Welcome to another beautiful episode. We are here with somebody very special, but before we jump into it, I want to thank our sponsors, EAP and Caddo Management, for everything they do to keep us going here on PrizeCast. Remember, like, subscribe, and share. We're on YouTube, and we're here every weekday on the PrizeFest Facebook page. So now, ladies and gentlemen, get ready for a very special guest live from Boston, Massachusetts. Say a big hello and give a huge virtual hug to our friend Mark Newberg. Mark, how's it going?
Great up until you told everybody to hug me, Gregory. How are you?
Everything's great. You know, again, it's the quarantine. And as I've told everyone in my life, my quarantine is my kryptonite. I'm not good, and I would be.
Are you telling me that you're an extrovert on the Myers-Briggs, Gregory?
Yes, it's a big E extrovert. And I got to tell you, I miss everyone. I miss everything. I miss you terribly. And I want to
I'm an I, so I can't say the same.
Well, you say that, but you know, I've seen you hug, Mark. You are somebody who is you're an E in an I disguise, I think, is what that is. So why don't we, just to give people context about who you are and how special you are, both to our Startup Prize community, but also to the world. Tell folks about what you do.
All right. Well, and as you said, I live outside Boston, but I lived in Louisiana for 8 or 8.5 years. I run my own strategic consulting firm called Stockbridge Advisors, which focuses on impact and ESG. And really, you can just think about it as helping organizations and senior leaders of those organizations do good and do well at the same time.
You know, while you are nationally recognized for all the work that you're doing right now, and I know that you are being tapped by big corporations to help think through what we should all be doing during the quarantine, what I've heard is you're mostly known for your Zoom backgrounds. And I'm wondering if maybe you could take us through a few of your favorites.
Sure. And this is one of those things where everyone's always looking at a bunch of people in really tiny windows. And to get your point across in a video meeting, you don't always have to be the one talking. And it's a good creative outlet for me when I'm on Zoom calls that go forever. So I'll give you three of them. The first one is really simple. If you have to step away from the camera, everyone always wants to know, where did you go? What were you doing? I was getting coffee. That's what I was doing.
Nice. Good. Well, yeah. Now I know why people are raving about it. Yes.
Right. You 100%. Don't have to answer the question. There you go. The background speaks for itself. Yes. The second, you know, sometimes there are dreary backgrounds or you're not necessarily in the right part of the house to look like you've properly framed yourself. Well, I just was looking for something that was a little bit more homey. That's a Frank Lloyd Wright living room in Buffalo, New York that I drew some fake flames on. And finally, if I don't feel like expressing my opinion on a call, but, you know, I have a clear reaction, I'll just go to this.
And then Grumpy Mark.
Everybody knows what I'm thinking.
Well, they're certainly they're not going to make many mistakes off of that. You know, I'm curious, you know, you're somebody who is really looking at the landscape and looking at what's out there. I'd like to know the way that entrepreneurs and innovators and small business people are thinking, or how you think they're thinking as you sort of are able to survey the folks that you're surveying.
Sure. And so, I mean, the first thing to do is recognize that small business means a bunch of different things. It's everything from a high growth entrepreneur coming out of, say, the Louisiana Startup Prize or a Mass Challenge or a Y Combinator, with prospects of at some point taking venture capital money or accessing the capital markets, to the mom and pop grocery store or dry cleaner that you think of as a Main Street business. That those are the ones that are closed right now. That you sit at home and you think, man, I wish I could go to X, Y, or Z. And they're really hurting and they have really different prospects and problems. And you can go all the way up to firms that have 495 employees that are still considered small. So it's a it's one question that's really a whole bunch of different questions. But to generalize, I think folks are doing the best they can with what they have and what they have access to. They're also worried, but they also care a lot about the communities that they're in. And that's before we even start talking about what recovery looks like. So that's my answer to a complicated question dressed up as a simple one.
So, you know, when you look at innovation and entrepreneurship and even sort of the gumption to be a small business person, I mean, can those folks really live in an environment like this? I mean, what happens to that type of energy and way forward when you have a health crisis like this?
So can it survive? Yeah. Can it thrive? Yeah, it also can, but it looks different. I mean, this isn't a point where I'd be telling someone to quit their job to go and start a new business. That's not a good idea. But it is a good time to think really deeply about what the purpose of your business is, what the assets are that you have, and how you can use them to help your community, which also helps you and your family and your employees. I've used this as an example before, but Gregory, did PrizeCast exist a month ago?
It did not, no.
was it something that you were planning on doing a month ago?
Not really. I mean, I will tell you that, no, it's not.
But you got together virtually with the team and said, hey, what can we do with everything that's in the prize family? The startup prize, film prize, food prize, music prize. I left one out, but I maybe left two out. But
we could spend a whole show talking about all the prizes. But yes, you're right, Mark. We did not start this prior to this health crisis.
Right. 100%. But the crisis forced you to be innovative, right?
Yes. I feel like I'm being forced into this place where I'm having to give a mea culpa. But yes, we would like to think we are being innovative. Yes.
I think you are. So innovation doesn't have to stop. It just has to focus on what's truly within the reach right now of the organization based on what it has access to and its capabilities.
So how do you balance that where we have so many viewers out there that are small business people, entrepreneurs, we have filmmakers, we have musicians out there. How do you draw that line between innovation in sort of working within the community and then a survival mode? And then how do you sort of take one to sort of leverage the other to create success?
You have to start by understanding that it's not necessarily a straight line and it's not the same line for each business or entrepreneur. But the reason I start with taking care of yourself and your family and your friends is you have to be able to survive first. Sometimes innovation will help you thrive. Sometimes it will help you come up with a new way to pay the bills. But if you can't come up with a way to pay the bills, then you can't do big, bold, fantastic things. So what I tell people in organizations to do a lot is dream rationally. And what that really means is take care of the things that have to be taken care of first and don't reach for things that you know in the back of your head you can't grasp. Or to say it differently, make sure the foundation is solid before you start reaching for the things that you can't yet describe or define.
Mark, that is a beautiful sentiment, the idea of dreaming rationally. And you've done a phenomenal job really taking us through the thought process of the way these entrepreneurs, small business people and innovators and even the artists should be thinking right now and really what they should be doing. I'm now curious about us. What should we be doing to help cheer on these efforts? And what can we do to support what they're doing to hopefully create some semblance of success?
Yeah. So when you ask me that, my mind immediately goes to the framework I used earlier for the entrepreneurs. And I think for individuals, so let's just talk as individuals now, I would take two parts of that framework and put them together. The need to take care of and focus on yourself, your family, and your friends, and your community. Those two sort of merge. If you're in a position or an economic position to be fortunate enough to still be able to order food from restaurants, find local restaurants that are offering takeout or delivery. Try them, support them, tell your friends about them, preferably on social media so that your friends can then share. Artists, before this happened, had in many cases started selling online. I know a lot of us are stuck inside houses now and noticing that there should be a picture there on the wall, or there shouldn't be a picture there on the wall. And wouldn't it be cool if we could do this, because now I'm working in a room I didn't intend and I'd like it to feel more inspirational. You know where artists sell online. Etsy is just one example. But you can also look for community newsletters that talk about the things that are available in communities. Where I live outside Boston sends a newsletter around every week telling us what's open and who's pivoting. And it's a great way to be involved and engaged in your community economically without actually being able to go out and engage the way we used to before the crisis hit.
And I mean, do you feel, you know, it's interesting. It's such a great point. I mean, you know, in Shreveport, we have a Facebook page called 318 Curbside Eats, and I see a lot of artists sort of advertising their work online. Is there a new sort of local wave that is created by something like this that could possibly last after this, that leaves us in a place where we're really utilizing our community better?
Yeah, there can be. The challenge with that is always to make sure that it's a model that's centered around a community anchor institution. Remember what I said about dreaming rationally and not sort of exceeding your grasp? One of the things that happens a lot during crises is everybody gets really motivated to do something, and fantastic ideas and initiatives are launched. But when the crisis recedes, people go back to doing what they did before because that's what they do and what they should be doing. And some of those initiatives have the tendency to sort of fade away because there's no infrastructure to run them. So I look at an organization like the Prize Foundation as a cultural institution in Shreveport. And then you start asking, what of the new community-driven initiatives or innovations that rise up in response to the crisis can be supported by, doesn't have to be a Prize Foundation, but the community anchor institutions that already exist and will continue to exist in whatever community you live in, wherever it is. That's the important thing to think through, because then you will have lasting innovation and more tightly knit communities out of a common crisis.
Yeah, and I think it would be phenomenal if this sort of hyper-local mentality that seems to be everywhere in the country, you know, I of course have ties back to Austin and watching all my Austin friends get super local about where they eat, you know, how they utilize the music scene, and the same thing going on here. And it's pretty cool to hear that it's going on all over the country and in Boston too. As I said before, you are somebody who has been tapped by a lot of people to think deeper about what this looks like on the other side. You know, we talked about that survival, and let's just, you know, evolve and take that next step forward. What does this look like on the other side, and how does somebody sort of prepare themselves now for what they should be ready to do once it's time to spring into action and the world gets back to normal?
Okay. Well, first, understand that nobody has a real crystal ball here, and anyone who says they do is making it up. And the other side of this is going to roll out gradually. We know that. But I think the biggest thing that's changing here, and that's changing at the very earliest entrepreneurial level up to the biggest institutional level, is understanding the role that organizations have within the communities that they seek to serve. And you asked me a question at the Startup Prize last year, and it was something along the lines of, if there was a group of entrepreneurs about to set sail from a dock and you could shout one piece of advice to them as they started to sail off, what would it be? And I remember thinking about it for a minute and saying, my advice would be find your North Star. Figure out what it is and where it is and how to locate it at all times, because that's the thing that'll guide you no matter what you're doing or when. And as long as you can find it in the sky, you'll be able to chart your course by it. And since then, I've sort of evolved that. I'm not the first person to talk about a North Star theory for entrepreneurs, but I've sort of evolved that into being able to explain what it is you do, why you do it, and the problem you exist to solve. And I think organizations, both large and small, for-profit, non-profit, and everything in between, are starting to realize, or will realize, that they have to take that purpose component and build it deeper into their operations. It'll make them better organizations, and it'll make the communities that they support better places to live and work.
Mark Newberg, incredibly inspirational words. I cannot tell you what a great notion, that whole idea of finding purpose and that North Star concept that you have. One last question. If you were going to take that notion of that North Star and really sort of put it in one song that you play, you know, the boombox is above your head, you're playing it as these entrepreneurs, these innovators, these small business people get onto that boat, they're in treacherous waters, they're heading towards a bright future. What is that one song you play them?
Comeback Song by Darius Rucker.
What can I say? I mean, we will go out on Darius Rucker's Comeback Song. Mark Newberg, thank you for being the bright light and the amazing spirit that you are. Big virtual hugs to your wife, Lexi. Thanks for being on PrizeCast today. Remember, everybody else, like, share, and subscribe. Mark, thank you so much. We will see you on the flip side. Viva the PrizeCast.
Thank you, Gregory. See y'all in Shreveport as soon as we can travel again. And baby, I know.